The oscillation of a string on a musical instrument depends on its length and tension. It produces high and low tones. The mathematical description of this oscillation resembles that of seismic waves. But how exactly do seismic waves oscillate in the Earth, and how do they propagate? The wave equation provides an answer to this question. It is important in order to understand the propagation of the various types of seismic waves in the Earth and to evaluate them quantitatively. Hello and welcome. In this video, I will deduce how the movement of an oscillating string can be described mathematically. Furthermore, I will also show you how this simple description can be applied to the significantly more complex propagation of seismic waves. The assumptions and formulas necessary for this fit together like pieces of a puzzle. Let me now qualitatively introduce you to the puzzle pieces involved. Here, the string should be oriented parallel to the x-axis and is made to oscillate in the direction of y. Upon being plucked, it leaves its equilibrium state and deformation moves along the string. I will now describe the displacement u as a function of the location along the x-axis and the time t. For this purpose, we will now look at the small section of the oscillating string. This section is stretched by the tension tau. This tension can be described by the force F. To do so, we use Newton's first law. The force F equals the mass m times the acceleration a. Hence, the force on the upper end equals tau times sine theta 2, and the force on the lower end is tau times sine theta 1. The difference is the force acting on the section. This is the one-dimensional equation of motion for our string, the first piece of the puzzle. On the other side of the equation, we substitute the mass m with the density rho times the length dx of the section of the string reduced to 1d. The acceleration is the second-order partial derivative of the displacement u over time. If the displacement values are small, the angle theta is also small, and the sine can be substituted by the gradient. F equals tau times du of x plus dx and t, differentiated with respect to dx minus du over dx. In the next step, we approximate the first term in the brackets, that means the force on the upper end. This is the sum of the force on the lower end du of x and t over dx plus the change along the path dx. Second order derivative of u of x and t over dx squared times dx. These are the first two terms of a Taylor series. You can see that these two terms cancel each other out and the result is tau d2u over dx squared times dx equals rho dx d2u over dt squared. This can be rearranged to give the second order spatial derivative of u equals 1 divided by v squared times the second order time derivative of u. Here, the wave velocity v equals the square root of tau divided by rho. This means that the velocity v depends on the physical properties of the string, the tensile stress tau and the density rho. A higher tension results in a greater restoring force and hence in a higher velocity. A higher density describes a larger inertial mass, thereby reducing the wave velocity. That is why the thinner, more highly tensioned strings of a ukulele produce higher pitched sounds than those of a contrabass. This is the one-dimensional wave equation. I will now show you what this means for the oscillation of the string. For this purpose, we need to find a solution for the displacement u, which fulfills the wave equation. The solution of the wave equation can generally be expressed as a function of the spatial variable x plus minus the velocity v multiplied by the time t. This can be shown directly by forming the partial derivatives over space and time. One special form of this is the movement of a harmonic wave. U of x and t equals a cosine of omega t plus minus kx. Hence, both the location x as well as the time t occur in the argument of the trigonometric function. This means that the wave oscillates over time but also in space. At a fixed point in time, let's look at a photo of the string, there are wave peaks and troughs at various locations. Or at a fixed location, let's hide the right and left parts of the string and concentrate on a small section. In this case, the wave peaks and troughs change over time. The spatial distance between two wave peaks is called the wavelength. The time interval is called the period. To further describe the oscillation, we now also need to observe the boundary conditions and initial conditions of the tension string. How is it held in place and where and how is it plucked? But that would exceed the scope of this lesson. I have now derived the one-dimensional wave equation and introduced solutions for it. This is the basis for further developing it for three dimensions. As is the case in 1D, density determines the propagation velocity of seismic waves in the Earth. But not only that, the elastic properties of what is beneath the surface also influence the velocity of the waves. In order to put together the wave equation for 3D cases, we require another set of puzzle pieces which were not necessary for 1D. I will now introduce them to you in a simplified manner. As was the case with the string, stresses also exist within the Earth, and these stresses are also transformed into their formations. The how is described by a state equation. It relates the elastic properties of the Earth to each other. For this, we use Hooke's law. It describes in general how stress deforms a physical body. Stress sigma ij equals C ij kl times deformation epsilon kl. Sigma and epsilon are tensors. They describe stress and deformations in 3D. C is a fourth order tensor and describes how stresses are transformed into deformation. It is assumed that the material found in the interior of the Earth has approximately the same physical properties in all spatial directions. We call this isotropic. This simplifies the application of the law. The stress sigma then appears as a function of the deformation epsilon and the Lamé parameters lambda and mu. They describe the elastic properties of the Earth. In this case, mu is the shear modulus. It indicates how easily a medium can be sheared. The greater this value, the more readily it shears. This state equation will be inserted into the homogeneous 3D equation of motion in the next step. It is similar to the equation of motion in 1D and describes a propagating wave without taking into consideration the stimulating force, that means far away from the seismic source. This combination allows the equation of motion to be formulated using displacement terms. The many nebula operators, put simply, stand for the spatial derivations in 3D. We solve this equation by separating the displacement field u into a scalar potential phi and a vector potential psi. Even if this appears complex at first glance, this separation leads to two simple solutions for the equation of motion. The seismic wave equations for P and S waves, in 3D of course. These solutions have a form similar to that of the one-dimensional wave equation, but describe seismic longitudinal waves and shear waves. The wave velocities are therefore Vp equals the square root of lambda plus 2 mu divided by rho and Vs equals the square root of mu divided by rho. That brings us to the end of this qualitative derivation. I will show you the solution of both wave equations here. Both equations describe plane waves which propagate in an arbitrary direction. In complex exponential notation of the trigonometric function, we can recognize the similarity to the harmonic wave in 1D. You have seen how the derivation of the wave equation consists of four steps. First, writing out the equation of motion. Second, applying the state equation of the material properties. Third, transformation to the wave equation, and fourth, solving the equation that describes the wave propagation. The solution of the wave equation then indicates how the waves oscillate in time and space. Furthermore, it also indicates what the propagation velocity of the waves depends on. In the case of the string, it is density and tension. And in the Earth, it depends on density and elastic properties, but to different extents for P and S waves. You have learned that the derivation of the wave equation in 1D and 3D is composed of four similar parts, allowing an oscillating string or a seismic wave to be described in its entirety.